Hi, I'm Louise from the Ontario Science Centre. You may have noticed that yeast can be hard to find in the stores these days. And I think it's because many of us are doing a lot of bread baking. Well, if you want to bake bread, but you can't find active dry yeast, what do you do? Well, the thing is, this type of yeast was only invented during World War II, but people have been baking bread for thousands of years using microbial fermentation. You may not realize this, but the yeast and the other microbes that we need to carry out this fermentation are all around us. And it's just a matter of making a stable culture of these microbes. So what I'm going to be talking about today is how to make your own sourdough starter to leaven baked goods using things that are probably already in your kitchen. When we're talking about leavening baked goods, we're referring to methods to introduce airiness into the final product so that we get something that's soft and airy rather than hard and dense. Now, there's two main ways to do this. The first method is to use a carbonate salt, such as baking soda, that will react with acids in the dough or batter and generate carbon dioxide gas bubbles, which give us the leavening effect that we want. The other way to do it is with microbial fermentation. Now, fermentation is the extraction of energy from carbohydrates in the absence of oxygen, and certain microbes can carry out this process, such as yeast. And by doing so, they also generate carbon dioxide, which gives us the leavening effect that we want. So any type of bread baking with yeast is actually a fermentation process. Now, active dry yeast, probably what you're most familiar with when you're doing bread baking, is composed of strains of yeast that have been selected to generate a lot of carbon dioxide gas in a short amount of time so that we have a relatively short rise period for the dough. Now, sourdough starter is a stable culture of naturally occurring yeasts and bacteria. The yeast, in the first stage of fermentation, generate carbon dioxide gas, which gives us the leavening effect. And then they eventually start to generate ethanol as a byproduct. And that ethanol is a simple alcohol, and it evaporates during the baking process. Bacteria generate lactic acid as a byproduct of their fermentation process. And that lactic acid gives us the characteristic sour taste of sourdough. To form a sourdough starter culture, we need three things. A source of microorganisms, also called microbes, and that includes yeast and bacteria, carbohydrates, which will serve as food for the microorganisms, that includes starches and sugars, and water. The microorganisms we need are found everywhere, but they will naturally want to cluster around food sources, and plants are the ultimate source. They capture light energy and store part of that energy in the form of carbohydrates. We will find the microorganisms we need on the outsides of plants, and especially around parts of the plant that store carbohydrates, such as fruit. Strawberries are a good example. This contains stored sugars. Seeds and grains, like this brown rice, contain carbohydrates, which serve as energy for growing plants, but also for other organisms. So this is a really good source for microorganisms. There are also plants that store their carbohydrates in their roots, like potato plants. The microorganisms needed for fermentation can be found on the skin of this potato. All we need to make a sourdough starter culture are a source of microorganisms, carbohydrates, and water. If you use a whole grain flour, you get two things in one: the microorganisms clinging to the outside of the grains and the carbohydrates stored inside the grains. Any type of whole grain flour will work. So of course there's whole wheat flour, but there's other whole grain flours that can be used, such as rye and oat. Other examples include pumpernickel and spelt. But don't forget there's also whole flours made from other seeds and grains, such as brown rice flour, cornmeal made by grinding down whole corn kernels. There's also flours made from peas and beans. You can actually also use dried breadcrumbs. If you have some stale bread, if you dry this and grind it down into crumbs, this will work because all the microorganisms we need are clinging to the outside of this bread and is a great source of carbohydrates. If all you have is
all-purpose flour and you don't have a whole grain flour, it will just take a little bit more time to establish a starter culture, as there are not as many microorganisms in here as there are in whole grain flours. And that's because the outside hulls of the wheat grains have been removed during the milling process. We can kickstart the process of making an active culture by obtaining microorganisms that are clustered around fruits and seeds, using water to rinse them off. So here are some examples. I've got some dried fruit here, apricots, raisins, cranberries, and a dried fig here. We can also get microorganisms by rinsing off seeds and grains, such as corn kernels. If you're soaking beans or rice, you can use that water. So I have some rice and lentils here. You can also get yeast and microorganisms from the sediment that's found at the bottom of beer and wine, bearing in mind that the yeast used in beer brewing is selected for their ability to act more slowly than the strains used in bread baking. They don't generate as much carbon dioxide, and they're able to tolerate higher alcohol concentrations. To get started, we need a clear container to store the starter culture. It would also be good to have a kitchen scale, but if you don't have one, you can use volume measurements. It just won't be as accurate. So I have a glass jar here, and I've weighed it beforehand without the lid, and I've recorded the mass on the label. To make the starter, we can use any whole grain flour, and we can provide additional microorganisms from the outsides of dried fruits or seeds by rinsing with water. If you're starting with all-purpose flour, like I am today, it's a good idea to add those extra microorganisms. So I've got 30 grams of all-purpose flour here, and I'm going to add this to the jar. And then I'm going to record the starting mass of flour. If you're using volume measurements, 1 tablespoon of flour is about 9.5 grams, and 1 tablespoon is 15 milliliters. So for 30 grams of flour, I'll need 3 tablespoons and 1/2 teaspoon. Next, I need to add an equal mass of water. And at the same time, I'm going to add the microorganisms from the outsides of these raisins. I have 30 milliliters of room temperature water here. That's 2 tablespoons. Now remember that the density of water at this temperature is 1 gram per milliliter. So this is equal to 30 grams of water. I'm going to add the raisins and then swirl it around. Now I've done this ahead of time, and these raisins have been soaking for about 30 minutes. And you may have noticed that the color of the water has changed and it's a bit cloudy. These are the microorganisms we need, and likely some of the sugars that have come out of the fruit. So it's up to you. You can add the water right away, or you can wait a bit to extract some of the sugars from the fruit. These sugars, they'll just add to the food source for the microorganisms. So I'm going to use this. I'm adding the water to the jar. Now at this point, it's up to you whether you want to leave the fruit in your starter or take it out, and I prefer to leave it out so it doesn't add to the final mass. Now at this point, we need to stir well, and we need to make sure all of the flour is wetted down. And once you've done that, you can put the lid back on and record the date.
Now that you have a sourdough starter, the next step is to find a warm spot in your house to store it. Yeast grow best at 30 degrees Celsius, so a sunny window will work, also putting it on top of a water heater. You can also put it in your oven with the light on. Just remember to take it out if you need to use your oven. You're going to have to check your starter every 24 hours for signs of bubbles, and how long this takes will depend on what you started with. But it'll certainly go faster if you've kickstarted the process with dried fruit. Now, every 24 hours, you will need to feed your starter, and that means removing part of the starter culture to bring it down to its original starting mass, and then adding in an equal mass of fresh flour and water. By around 4 to 5 days, hopefully you should start to see lots of bubbles on the surface, and that's a good sign. At this point, you're going to start feeding it every 12 hours, and this will hopefully get us to a really active culture very quickly. Two things to note, besides the bubbles, you'll notice the consistency will change. It'll be more like a thin yogurt, and it'll also smell maybe fruity, very tangy. Every time you feed your sourdough starter culture, you will need to mark the level. I like using a piece of colored tape with the upper edge lined up with the level inside the jar, and that way I can just peel it off and reapply as need be. The whole purpose of marking the level is so that we can track how high this rises after you feed it. What we're after is a really active culture that doubles approximately in size within 8 hours of feeding. It takes on average about 7 days to get there after you first form your culture, but it could take up to 14 days. If you get to 14 days and it's still not doubling in size, you can try to kickstart the whole process again with some more dried fruit or a whole grain flour. Now, at this point, I should say that for subsequent feedings after day one of creating your starter, you generally want to use and refined flour, like all-purpose flour. And the reason for that is because we don't want to introduce more yeast and bacteria to compete with what's already there. The whole purpose of cutting down your starter culture each time you feed it is to try and select for the yeast that generate a lot of carbon dioxide very quickly. Remember, what's in your starter culture is an entire microbiome of different microorganisms, and they're all competing for the same nutrient source. By dividing your culture, you're giving a chance for the yeast that we want to take over the starter culture. If your sourdough starter culture changes color, and I mean if it starts to show green or black or maybe orange and pink streaks, it's time to throw it out and start over. Also use your sense of smell. If it starts to smell bad, no longer fruity and tangy smelling, it's time to throw it out and start over again. Now, most sourdough starter recipes recommend starting with a large amount of flour, 100 grams or maybe even more. But as I've shown you, you don't need to start with such a large amount. 20 or 30 grams is sufficient. And that way you're not consuming so much flour during the whole process of creating an active culture. And you're also not creating as much discard. And that's what they call the amount of starter culture that you remove each time you feed it. Now, as for the discard, don't throw it out. I actually store all of my discard in a large container in my fridge. And there's lots of recipes that make use of it. So you can make things like English muffins and pizza. It's also possible to substitute into regular baking recipes for the flour and liquid portion an approximate equal mass of the discard. But that will take some courage in terms of experimenting, but opens up whole new horizons in terms of baking. So we would love to see what you're doing. Please send us your photographs of your sourdough starter and your baked goods. And I hope you have lots of fun experimenting in the kitchen. Thanks so much for watching.